Okay. Hi, this is Richard Hall here, and looking at the night sky. Hang on a second while I just fire this thing up.
Laptop on it. There we go.
Got it. Okay. Well, yes, welcome along, and we'll be looking at the night sky that we have in the summer stars. And I think just a little while ago I was looking at the particular regions in Orion and so on. Also, as we go along, I always like to thank Dan Broughton for supporting this program. Well, looking out, I guess, is the most well-known constellation in the sky, which of course is the constellation of Orion. And we looked in that in some detail a couple of weeks ago. You can't miss it. The thing I suppose that stands out most of all is, first of all, the big bright stars, which in fact are very, very rare stars. They are giants, some of them tens and tens of thousands of times brighter than the sun, but they at enormous great distances. And while only one in a million stars is as bright as these objects, they stand out over vast distances. And also laying behind these big bright stars was a huge dark cloud in which new stars were being formed. So we looked at that and the Sword of Orion. So Orion, I guess, is one of the best known constellations. But I thought what we would do today is go through and have a look at some of the other bright stars that are in our sky so we can identify them. So the moment you've picked up where Orion is in the sky, the three belt stars, the pot, you look above and to the right of Orion, you'll see the brightest star in the sky. And I do mean the brightest star. It is a star, and there are no big bright planets in the sky at the moment. And that star is Sirius. So that is the brightest star in the sky. Unlike the big bright stars of Orion, actually, Sirius is actually one of the local stars, although it is in fact a lot brighter than our own sun. It's quite a considerably hotter. It's a sort of blue-white star. But anyway, it's about 25 times brighter than the sun and ferociously hot and only just over sort of 8 light years away. Okay, so this is Sirius, the one we can pick, and it's often called the Dog Star. And the reason for that is partly is because it's in the constellation of Canis Major, but also the story of the dog goes back thousands of years in time. I'll tell you about that story later on. But not only is Sirius a white hot star, and it's actually a lot younger than our sun, maybe only a sort of fraction of the age, maybe just a few hundreds of millions of years old. But what was discovered about Sirius, which made it very, very famous, was in a large telescope, and you do need a large telescope, they discovered that Sirius is not a single star, it is a binary. And our sun is a star, and it's a single star with its planets going around it. But many of these stars out there are multiple systems in which you've got two or more stars orbiting around each other. And in turn, they've got their own planets. Well, this has got a companion star, but it's exceedingly faint. It's 10,000 times fainter to Sirius. And that's why it was so difficult to see in the first place. So this is quite an interesting object. So if we have a look at it in more detail, first of all, its orbit is around about 50 years it takes to go around the star. But it's exceedingly small. But if you put the Earth alongside it, the Earth would actually be slightly larger. It's about 1,000 kilometres. Its diameter is about 1,000 kilometres less than that of our Earth. But at the same time, this little tiny star actually contains as much mass as the entire solar system. It's more massive than our sun. This means, of course, it's exceedingly dense. And what it is actually is what we call a white dwarf. It's a core of a star that was the companion of Sirius millions of years ago. It was much, much brighter, bigger and brighter, but it's burnt itself out. See, the bigger a star is, the quicker it goes through its lifetime. And it's very, very bright. It would have been very, very bright. But now it's shed all its matter away. And it's that all we've got left is the core of the star, which is gradually cooling. But of course, the magnificent thing about this this object we're looking at is made mostly of carbon. And indeed, as it gradually cools now, we know we can actually hear the sounds of it. It's actually crystallizing. And what is it turning into? Of course, it's turning into a diamond. But not a little diamond that you can put on your ring. This is a diamond the size of the Earth. However, despite that, even in future times, don't imagine that we're going to be going out mining diamonds out on the on this other star, which we call the pup. The fact is that because you've got so much mass concentrated into such a short area, if you landed on the pup, you'd have the uncomfortable feeling, momentarily that is, of weighing something in the region of 10,000 tons, and your body would be immediately flattened on the surface and spread over about a kilometre. So I'm afraid white dwarfs, while they may be made of magical things, they're simply too dangerous to get near. They are essentially stellar corpses. Well, if we then come back from Sirius and then head back towards the belt of Orion, going in a straight line, we come on the other side of the Orion is another big bright star. But this is, unlike Sirius, which is whitish in colour, this one has got a deep orange-yellow colour. This is all Aldebaran. It is part or eye of the bull in Taurus the bull. It too is a bright star. It's relatively close compared with the stars of Orion, but it too is a giant star. Right. I said earlier that about Sirius, once upon a time there was another star which was also blue white, and then that turned in time into what we call expanded into what we call a red giant, a red star. Then it blew out its outer layers, just leaving the core, the white dwarf. Well, Aldebaran is in that final stages. It's 65 light years away. It's over 400 times brighter than the Sun, 425, but its diameter is 44 times that of the Sun. So this is a red giant, and this is what Sirius is going to look like in a few millions of years when it begins to use up the rest of its hydrogen fuel it has there at the moment. So that's Aldebaran. And if we pass in that line from Sirius through Orion, past Aldebaran, we come to the Pleiades star cluster in the sky. And of course, that is undoubtedly the most famous star cluster anywhere, okay, in the sky. We're also known, of course, down here as Matariki, also as the Seven Sisters. And the reason for that is the reason why it's called the Seven Sisters. On a clear, dark night, if you've got good vision, you can see roughly seven stars there. But in fact, this is actually a cluster of stars containing about something in the region of 400 stars. And as I mentioned earlier, stars are all different brightnesses, and the brighter a star is, the rarer it is. So you've got nine big bright stars there, but there are hundreds of them smaller and fainter than those big bright ones you can see. Now, these Seven Sisters are very important to me as someone who's become really interested in astronomy. Donkey's years back, when I was back in England, all I had to look at things was a pair of binoculars. And I used to study one of the stars in the Seven Sisters. In fact, this is double star. They're actually double. They appear in the sky close together. The brighter of the pair is Atlas, and next to it is Pleione. And both of them are two of the Seven Sisters. And it's Pleione that I was particularly interested in, because most of the time when you look at the two, Pleione, she's about half the brightness of Atlas. But every now and again, you go out and suddenly she was brighter than Atlas. And this is what we call a variable star. It's a very hot blue star, but it's subject to gigantic eruptions on it, which for a few days, it makes it doubles, more than doubles in brightness. And what we've discovered about Pleione is that it's a rapidly rotating star. And as it formed, it was rotating more and more. As it contracted, it rotated faster and faster. And so what we've ended up with, instead of a nice round sun, we've ended up with one that's like a big lens, and it's hurling matter off of the off of its equator. And energy is interacting with this cloud of material that's hurled off. Right? So this is Pleione. She is, incidentally, just under 400 light years away, so some considerable distance compared with Sirius. Remember, it's only 8 light years away. And if you actually see her close, we'd find that Pleione is 190 times brighter than the sun. And so that's what led me into astronomy, studying this this eruptive variable star. And you will find that many stars at certain stages of their life become variable. Hopefully that's not going to happen with our sun, because, boy, if anything varied than our sun, life on her Earth will rapidly become extinct. Anyway, folks, we're going to have a short break now, and what we're going to be doing is listening to Michael Tume's Listen. And when we come back, we'll look at some of the other spectacular objects in our night sky. Okay, folks, you're back with Richard, looking at their night sky. And whereas just a little while ago we've been sort of exploring all the stars where you're looking absolutely due north, we're going to go in the opposite direction now and turn around and see what we've got in our sky in the southern skies. Right? So if we sweep around and we look out across, we see another bright star. In fact, the second brightest star in the entire sky, and that is actually the star Canopus. Right? And unlike Sirius, it's slightly less faint than Sirius, but in fact it's a lot brighter star, it's just a lot further away. Canopus is another giant star. If you imagine getting close to it, it's over 300 light years away, and it's 13,600 times brighter than the sun. It's got a mass of about 8.5 times that of the entire solar system, and its diameter, although it's about the same brightness as the sun, only slightly brighter its surface area, its diameter is 65 times that of the sun. And for those of you watching some of this on TV, I've just brought the sun up alongside. Right? Now, you've got to remember, our sun is a pretty gigantic object. You could fit a million Earths inside the sun. Right? Now, look at this. You look at Sirius compared to Canopus. It's truly a gigantic star. Okay. Well, if you look beneath Canopus, you'll see two patches of light, which look like detached portions of the Milky Way. But in fact, these are not part of the Milky Way at all. This is the Large and the Small Magellanic Clouds. And what they are satellite galaxies of the Milky Way. So in other words, exactly the same way as the Moon is a satellite of the Earth, the Milky Way galaxy has got little galaxies which orbit around it, and two of them are very, very noticeable here from the southern hemisphere. Can't see these at all from the north. Now, the Large Magellanic Cloud is quite a spectacular object seen in binoculars, but certainly when you view it through a big telescope, because what you can do is actually explore a galaxy in detail. And the interesting thing is that because it is so close to our Milky Way galaxy, it's actually gradually being ripped apart. And it didn't start off being part of our galaxy. It actually came from what was known as the Andromeda galaxy, the great galaxy in Andromeda. And it sort of slipped away from there, being caught by our Milky Way galaxy, and has gradually been shredded and assimilated into the Milky Way. But because of all these tidal effects we have, you've got some enormous amount of star formation taking place because it's so volatile there. And the bright area, which you can pick up with the pair of binoculars, okay, this is the Tarantula Nebula. And it is the biggest star forming region, the closest one that we can observe in detail, bigger than anything we're seeing in the Milky Way. And here we've got millions of stars in the process of forming. But not only that, many of these stars are supergiant stars. So when they form, they're not just, you know, a little bit brighter than our sun. We're talking about stars which can be up to a million times brighter than the sun. They only last for a few tens of thousands of years, and then they instead of turning into red giants, they end up by exploding into what we call supernova and so on. But surrounding them, where these big giants, the shock waves that come from these stars in turn are generating vast numbers of smaller stars similar to our sun and Sirius and so on. So that's the Large Magellanic Cloud, right? And then, of course, underneath that, we've got the smaller Magellanic Cloud. And when the Andromeda Galaxy is not visible in the sky, the Small Magellanic Cloud is the most distant thing that you can see without a telescope or binoculars. It lays, again, it's a dwarf galaxy. It is at a distance of 190,000 light years. In other words, when you look at this, we're looking at this thing through a telescope, we're seeing it as it was 190,000 years ago, long, long before the rise of humanity. Right? And of course, remember, if somebody's out there on a star in the Large Small Magellanic Cloud looking back on us, they're going to see the Earth as it was 190,000 years ago. Of course, we weren't around then at that particular time. Okay, but when you look at the small cloud in the telescope, it's got this definite tadpole shape. It's like the large cloud, it too is being torn apart by the gravitational tidal effects of the Milky Way. And dotted along the tail of the small cloud are, again, star-forming regions. But you need a big telescope in order to explore these. However, when you do go up and have a look at the small cloud, they're close to it, particularly noticeable with a pair of binoculars, but you can see it with the unaided eye, is what appears to be a fuzzy star. But this is no star. This object that you can see has got nothing to do with the small cloud. It is in fact a satellite of our Milky Way galaxy, and it's a particularly ancient one, what we call a globular cluster. And this is called 47 Toucanae. And the reason for this, we're in the constellation of Toucan. And when astronomers first located it, it was the 47th brightest star this was hundreds of years ago, before they realised that 47 Tucanae is no star. But you look at this in a telescope, and it's one of the most magnificent objects you can actually see. And for those of you watching this on TV, you've just seen it come up. It's a ball of about 300,000, 400,000 stars in this cluster. But the interesting thing is, when we look at these clusters, they are ancient. These are actually the building blocks of the galaxy, the bits that have been left over. And the age of these things goes back more than 10 billion years in age. So here we've got an ancient star system. As I say, they just, most of the other stars were swept up and swallowed up by a galaxy. But there's several hundred of these globular clusters. They're all at great distances from us. 47 Tucanae is 15,000 light years away. All right. But as I say, it's billions of years older than our own Milky Way galaxy. So who knows what's out there amongst those stars? But of course, it's going to be a long time. Remember, even travelling at the speed of light, light takes 15,000 years to get there. So it's going to be a long time before we'll ever think about exploring these objects. So that was that's looking at the south. So we're going to have another little break now. We're going to listen to Nocturne, which is A Secret Garden. Okay, folks, we'll be back with the night sky, and I thought we would finish it off by looking at what I call the cosmic emu. All right, now if you have a look at the Milky Way, which at this time in the south is rising straight upwards, it's got these dark patches, which are dark clouds blotting out the light of more distant stars. And on a clear dark night, it's definitely got this pattern which looks like a gigantic emu in the sky. And its neck coming out. So for those of you watching on TV, you can see where the emu is. Now, on the nestling on the top of the head of the emu is the Southern Cross, which is laying on its side at the moment. All right. And in the neck of the great emu are the pointer stars, which follow the cross around the sky. And the brightest of the two pointer stars is Alpha Centauri. And beyond the solar system, it is our nearest star system. But it's not, its distance is just 4.3 light years away. But while the stars of Alpha Centauri are similar to the Sun, well, it's a little bit different because instead of having a single star, we've got two suns, one slightly brighter than our Sun and the other slightly fainter. And the two stars slowly orbit around each other over a period, I think it was about 80 years. All right? So if you lived in the Alpha Centauri system, you wouldn't have one sun, you would have two. But the interesting thing is that with our modern technology, we've already detected planets out there. So we know that there's planets orbiting around these stars. All right. And if you were standing on the surface of one of these planets and looking back, well, the sun would appear as nothing more than a bright star in the constellation of Cassiopeia, which incidentally we can't see from here because it's in the northern hemisphere. So our sun would look just like a bright star. Now, all of those planets around Alpha Centauri, they might be just barren and lifeless worlds, a bit like our moon. But of course, there's always the possibility that if you've got a planet of the right size, at the right distance from a star, so it's receiving just the amount of right radiation, conditions would be available for life itself. So who knows what we might discover in the near future around these stars. And of course, this is what astronomers are searching for around other stars, is Earth-like planets in that zone where life can possibly exist. So that's what we're looking at. But I should point out to you that Alpha Centauri is often described as a triple star system because close by to the binary pair is another star, Proxima. Now, it's not really a true member of the system because the stars have different ages. Now, Proxima, which is the nearest star to the solar system, you can't even see without a telescope, is that faint. This thing is tens of thousands of times fainter than the sun. It's what we call an extreme red dwarf. But like Pleione we were looking at earlier on, it's subject to violent eruptions which blast material into space. It's what we call a flare star. And so you wouldn't want to be, we're not going to be looking for life around Proxima, even if it's a planet at the right distance, because these eruptions would have literally by now would rip the atmosphere of that planet off. So not a good place. However, something really interesting has happened. Just recently, scientists with radio telescopes have been picking up radio signals from the Proxima Centauri system. We know Proxima's got planets. Now, life shouldn't be able to exist there, but we keep on getting every now and again, we get this little tiny radio signal. And of course, people are speculating about, well, is it some sort of space station or something like that? Is it something that's come from another star or whatever? Is it some sort of natural thing? But the way in which it repeats, it doesn't appear to be like a natural process. So who knows? Maybe someone has got a big satellite up there and they're sort of keeping a close eye on us. Who knows? That's what's happening. So just to finish off, folks, just to remind you that Stonehenge is open at the moment from Wednesday through to Sunday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. We have guided tours, which can be organised, have to be organised, rather, if you want a guided tour around there. We do storytelling and so on. We have Stargazer Safari every Friday and Saturday evening. Come out and some of these wonderful things we've been looking at, the Tarantula Nebula, 47 Dukane. Come out and have a look at these things for the large telescopes we have. So that's at 8 o'clock. Starting at 8 o'clock at Stonehenge on Friday and Saturday evenings. And finally, I should remember, mind you, a star date that we've got coming up, February 12th to 14th. It's a whole series of lectures, wine tasting, barbecues, telescope viewing, night sky tours. And it runs over three days there. So you have to sign in for it, though. And if you want to camp out there or caravan out there, you can do. All right, so that's star date that's coming up in the very near future from the 12th onwards. And at night, of course, we'll be doing tours of the night sky and telescope viewing. Finally, one final thing, if you'd like to learn more about our world, because we only ever see it in a glimpse in time, we've got a program called This Island Earth, Our World in Space and Time. And I'm afraid you've been listening to me, special presentation we're doing at Stonehenge, a lot of imagery, 7 o'clock on Saturday, February 20th. That's This Island Earth. And having said that, I am going to sign off now and catch you up in a couple of weeks from now.